Very good morning, dear students. This video is for class 10, subject science, chapter number 4, carbon and its compounds, and this is lecture number 30, which is a discussion lecture on NCERT in-text and exercise questions. So let us begin with the in-text questions first. At page number 61, the in-text questions that are given are: first question is, what would be the electron dot structure of carbon dioxide which has the formula CO2? And the solution will be that, as we have been given, that formula is CO2, where carbon is there. Carbon is having a valency of 4, oxygen is having a valency of 6. So we have 2 oxygens and 1 carbon. So we will arrange them in such a way that carbon is having its 2 electrons present like this, and the oxygen I'm representing it by orange color, and I'm representing the electron dots of oxygen with the orange color. So this way you can see that here these 2 double bonds are completing the valency of oxygen, and here also this oxygen is also getting complete its octet, and this carbon is also completing its octet by sharing the 4 electrons with the 2 electrons of each oxygen atom. So this is the electron dot structure of CO2. Question number 2 is, what would be the electron dot structure of a molecule of sulfur which is made up of 8 atoms of sulfur? And the hint which is being given here is that 8 atoms of sulfur are joined together in the form of a ring. So as we have been given at S8 molecule, and as we know that sulfur is having a valency of 6. As its atomic number is 16, so electronic configuration will be 2, 8, 6. So we are having 6 valence electrons. Now let us try to make S8 molecules electron dot structure in case of a ring. So if it is forming a ring, then 8 sulfur atoms can be arranged in this way. And as we know that sulfur is having a valency of 6, so it needs 2 more electrons, which it can gain by sharing its 2 electrons with other sulfur atoms. So one sulfur will share its 1 electron with the adjacent sulfur atom. So this way these 2 will share their 1-1 electron in the covalent bonding that I am representing here. This is what they are sharing in the covalent bonding. Now they are left with the 4-4 valence electrons, and that I am going to represent now. So this way you have to represent the electrons as the dots around the atoms. Now this structure is taking a shape of a ring, and we have arranged 8 sulfur atoms in a form of ring. Then come on the page number 68, and we have been given 3 questions here on this page. First question is, how many structural isomers can you draw for pentane? And the next question is, what are the 2 properties of carbon which leads to the huge number of carbon compounds we see around us? Now let us discuss these 2 questions. So the question is that how many structural isomers we can draw for pentane. Pentane is a carbon chain which is having a 5 carbon atoms present in it. So we have C5H. What is the formula? It's CnH2n plus 2. So it will be C5H12. Now let us see. So we have to draw the isomer structures for pentane. Pentane, which is having a formula of C5H12. Pentane means carbon atoms are present in the number 5. Now let us start making the structure for it. That we have 5 carbon atoms and their carbon atoms valencies is completed by using a monovalent atom, that is hydrogen here. So here in this way we are using 5, 5, 10, 11, 12 hydrogen and 5 carbon atoms. And this structure we can call is N-pentane, that is normal pentane. Now let us try making one isomer of it. If we draw carbon atoms in such a way that on the second carbon of either side, because we will start counting from there only, on the second carbon we have a methyl group attached and rest of the valencies of all the carbon atoms are fulfilled by hydrogen. So here you can count 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 11, 12. Just wait. We are having 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. So we have 12 hydrogens and again 5 carbon atoms. So what is that? This 1, 2, 3 and 4. So this is on second carbon we have a methyl group present here. So 2 methyl and what is left? Butane, because now this chain is consisting of 4 carbon atoms. So 2 methyl butane. We can also try with 3 carbon atoms arranged in a straight chain and second carbon is having 1 and here also we are having 1. So this way we have total number of carbon atoms 5 and complete the valencies using hydrogen atoms. So 3, 3, 3 and 3, 9, 12. So we have 12 hydrogen atoms and 5 carbon atoms. So this will be the structure 1, 2, 3. So on second carbon we have 2 methyl groups and the name for it will be 2,2-dimethyl. Now it's not butane, now it's propane. So the name will be 2,2-dimethyl propane. On page number 68, the second question was, what are the two properties of carbon which lead to the huge number of carbon compounds? So as we know that about 3 million organic compounds are known till date. And the reason for this huge number of organic compound is the important properties of carbon atom, which are catenation, tetravalency and small size. So catenation is the property of self-linking of carbon atoms. That means it can link with the another carbon atoms by covalent bonding and this chain can go to the infinite number of self-linking of carbon atoms. So the catenation is the property of self-linking of carbon atoms through covalent bonds to form a long straight chain, or it can be branched chain, or rings can be formed of different sizes. Carbon is having a unique quality to form the bonds with other carbon atoms, so as to form the long straight chains or branch chains or ring chains, and this gives the rise to large number of molecules present. The second property is tetravalency of carbon atom. As we know that it is having a valency of 4. So it is neither able to lose 4 electrons nor to gain 4 electrons. So it is having a property to make 4 covalent bonds with other carbon or some other elements. it can do covalent bonding, that is four covalent bonds it can make with other four atoms, which can be carbon or which can be atoms of some other element. So this property also helps to make the large number of molecules of carbon atom. Third property is its small size. When we have a atom in very small size, then what will happen? That the nucleus holds the shared pair of electrons very strongly. This way the bond carbon is making with some other atom is very strong, which gives rise to the covalent bonding between the carbon and carbon, or it can be some other atom like oxygen, hydrogen, nitrogen or sulfur. So all the bondings will be strong enough to keep the compounds stable. Now let us discuss the third question. On page number 68, the third question is, give the formula and electron dot structure of cyclopentane. So you must remember that we have cleared your doubt in case of this cyclopentane, that whenever carbon is arranged as a straight chain, so pentane will be having a formula of CnH2n+2. But when we form this ring of a straight chain of carbon atoms, it will have two hydrogens less, because the carbon atom will make covalent bonds with the extreme and other carbon atom, and the hydrogen will not be there. So now as we have the cyclopentane, we have the formula for it, C5H12, as we have done in the previous question. But for cyclopentane we will be having the formula C5H10. This we can also conclude after the structure we draw. So we have five carbon atoms arranged in the form of a cyclic structure, that means closed ring. So we can make it like this. Each carbon atom forms a covalent bond as it is an alkane chain, and the rest of the valencies are fulfilled by hydrogen for each carbon atom. So this way, how many hydrogens we have? We have 10 hydrogens in total to complete the valency of 5 carbon atoms arranged in a cyclic ring. So this way we have the formula C5H10, and this would be the structure for cyclopentane. At page number 69, we have another question, that is, draw the structure for the following compounds, and these are ethanoic acid, bromopentane, butanone and hexanal. So let us draw the structure for ethanoic acid first, as this name is telling us that we will be having two carbon in it, and oic acid, that is carboxylic acid functional group, is there. So we will be having two carbon atoms arranged in such a way that carbon of carboxylic acid is given the priority, and we know that carboxylic acid is COOH, and the rest of the valencies will be fulfilled by hydrogens. So this way the valency of both the carbon atoms are complete. So this will be the structure for ethanoic acid. Then we have bromopentane. So at first position of the pentane alkene chain we have bromine. So we have 5 carbon atoms, and at the first carbon we have a bromine substitutional group, and rest of the valencies of each carbon will be fulfilled by hydrogens. Here we will have the hydrogen. So this way the structure of bromopentane can be drawn. Then we have butanone. Non is for ketone functional group. So as we know that ketone group is not a terminal group, so it will come in between, and there are total number of carbon atoms 4. So we will draw 4 carbons. If The ketone group is present at the second carbon, that is C double bond O. Then rest of the valencies of carbon atoms will be fulfilled by hydrogen this way. So this would be the structure for butanon. Next is hexanal. Hexanal is the aldehyde group, that is CHO, and we have 6 carbon atoms arranged. So we have 6 carbon atoms. As we know that aldehyde group is the terminal group, so it will come at the end, and we will have double bond O and 1 H, and rest of the valencies of the carbon atoms will be fulfilled by hydrogen. So this way we will be completing the structure of hexanal. Here also we will have 1 hydrogen, and this carbon is already having its 4 valencies complete. Then the next question on the same page is, name the following compounds. And the first compound is CH2CH2Br. So we have 2 carbon atoms, 1 bromine is present at the first carbon, so it will be bromo. 2 carbons, eth. Single bonds are there, so it will be bromoethane, where bromo is the substitutional group, eth is the parent chain, and alkane is the word root, or you can say ethane is the word root. Then we have second, HCHO. So CHO is 1 carbon atom, aldehyde group is there, so the word root will be meth, and the functional group will be al. So methane is the parent chain and al is the functional group here, so we'll be having the name as methanol. Then we have CH3CH2CH2C double bond OCH. So in this way we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Total 6 carbon atoms are present here, so this chain will be an hexene. But we have to provide the naming also. So at the first carbon itself, the double bond is there because we have to give the priority due to the double bond. So the numbering will be this way. As the double bond is at the first position itself, so there is no need to mention the position. So how we are going to name it? The word root is hex. The prefix is ine. And the IUPAC name would be hexane. We are having triple bonds here, so it will be named as hexane. The next question on page number 71 is, why is the conversion of ethanol to ethanoic acid and is an oxidation reaction? So let us see the answer. That ethanol, when converted to ethanoic acid, as we know that it is a two-step process. First, ethanol gets oxidized and converted to ethanol. Then ethanol gets oxidized and converted to ethanoic acid. And how this reaction takes place? So we have ethanol, CH3CH2OH, and this is heated in the presence of alkaline KMnO4, that is potassium permanganate, and it forms CH3COOH and water. Now, as we have to take out the water from here, we have to add 1 hydrogen here. So here, this ethanol is utilizing the KMnO4's oxygen. It is taking the nascent oxygen atoms from it and getting oxidized. This is what actually happens in the process, that we have ethanol, CH3COOH, yani ke CH2OH, and 1 oxygen atom is attached to it. Then we have CH3 C double bond O H. So here what is happening? Earlier we were having OH. Now we are having double bond with the O. So OH, H2O is removed from here and oxygen is getting attached to it. So this is forming ethanol. Then this ethanol gets one more oxygen atom from the KMnO4 and gets oxidized to CH3COOH. And hence ethanol converts to ethanoic acid. So finally ethanol is converting into ethanoic acid by a two-step process, and as there is a addition of hydrogen to the ethanol to convert into ethanoic acid, and there is removal of hydrogen too, so this process is known as oxidation reaction. The next question on the same page is that if a mixture of oxygen and ethane is burned for welding, can you tell why a mixture of ethane and air is not used? And the solution for this is that when a mixture of oxygen and ethane is used for welding, that means when ethane is burned in the presence of oxygen, it gets a very high temperature, which is enough for melting the metals which are used in the welding purpose, because there is a complete combustion that takes place in the presence of oxygen only. But when mixture of ethane and air is used, then it leads to the incomplete combustion, because air is having only 20% of oxygen in it. So this ethane and air mixture will lead to the incomplete combustion, and it will produce a sooty flame which will not produce enough heat, which is the must requirement of the welding. So that is why oxygen and ethane mixture is used for welding and not the ethane and air. Next question is, how would you distinguish experimentally between an alcohol and a carboxylic acid? So as I have already told you that one test can be litmus paper test, because alcohol is neutral in nature while carboxylic acid is acidic in nature. So litmus paper will not turn its color when it is reacting with alcohol, but a blue litmus paper will turn red when it is dipped in the carboxylic acid because of its acidic nature. Then the next question is, what are oxidizing agents? The substances which oxidizes other substances, or they provide the oxygen to get them oxidized, or they remove hydrogens from a compound or from a substance, then these kind of substances are called oxidizing agents. Next syntax question is, would you be able to check if water is hard by using a detergent? And the answer to this question is that no, we will not be able to check the hardness of the water by using a detergent. Why? Because the detergents are the sulfonate salts of long chain carboxylic acids, and unlike soaps, they do not react with the calcium and magnesium ions which are present in the hard water. And that is why scum formation do not take place. Scum, that is insoluble grayish material, which is formed when the soap molecules, they react with the hard water, or you can say the magnesium and calcium ions present in the hard water. So here scum formation is not taking place, and the detergents, they are able to give a good lather in the hard water as well, and the soft water as well. That is why detergents cannot be used to check the hardness of the water. Now next question is, people use a variety of methods to wash clothes. Usually after adding the soap, they beat the clothes on the stone or beat it with a paddle, scrub with a brush, or mixture is agitated in a washing machine. Why is agitation necessary to get the clean clothes? Now, as we have been given various methods to agitate the clothes, Why it is necessary? Because this process helps to remove the dirt from the cloth. Now let us see how it happens. Suppose this is our cloth and it is having a dirt or grease or oil on it. So as we know that soap molecules or detergent molecules, they are having a structure of like this. It is having a hydrophobic end and a hydrophilic end. Hydrophilic end which will react with the water, and hydrophobic end will react with the grease or dirt present on the cloth. As we add up the soap to the solution which is having the cloth, then what happens? First, the soap molecules, they try to align themselves according to their nature. That means the hydrophilic end reacts with the water and the hydrophobic end wants to stay away from the water molecules, and hence it goes and sticks to the dirt or grease. If it is going and combining with the dirt molecules, although it is trying to remove it from the cloth, because it is trying to entrap it to form a micelle like this. And when the micelle formation takes place, although the dirt is entrapped in the micelle, but if we are not agitating the cloth, then what will happen? This dirt particle will remain on the cloth itself, because by itself it is not going to go anywhere. That is why agitation is necessary, because all these processes which are mentioned in the questions, they help in removing the dirt from the cloth, as they loosen up the bonds between the cloth fabric and the dust particles, and that is why we get a clean cloth. So all these methods which are mentioned in the question, they help in washing the clothes. Now let us see the exercise questions, and the first question is, ethane with the molecular formula C2H6 has how many covalent bonds in it? So the options given to you are 6, 7, 8 and 9 covalent bonds. So now let us draw the structure and see how many covalent bonds are there. So we have two carbon atoms, and as it is an ethane, so it will be having only single bonds. So how many hydrogens we will need? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So 6 hydrogens and 2 carbon atoms. So how many covalent bonds are there? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 and 7. So it will be having 7 covalent bonds. So B option is correct. Then we have been given butanone. Second question. Butanone is a 4 carbon compound with a functional group. As you can see in the name itself that it has been given butanone. So non is containing own suffix used for ketone functional group. So ketone will be the right option. Third question is, while cooking, if the bottom of the vessel is getting blackened on the outside, it means option A, the food is not cooked completely. B, the fuel is not burning completely. C, the fuel is wet. D, the fuel is burning completely. So the correct option will be B, because when the fuel is not burning completely, what happens? That means there is a blockage in the holes of the stove that you are using, and because of that, fuel is not burning completely and a sooty flame is coming out, which causes the blackening of the utensils which you are using. Question number 4 is, explain the nature of the covalent bonds formation in CH3Cl. Now let us try it and draw the structure. As the formula is CH3Cl, so it is having one carbon atom, but we know that carbon is having a valency of 4, so it has to make 4 bonds, or it needs 4 more electrons to complete its octet. So 4 bonds it can make like this, but there are 3 hydrogen atoms which can provide 1 hydrogen to the carbon by sharing it. So the one hydrogen, each hydrogen will share its one electron with the carbon, and hence three valencies of the carbon atom will be fulfilled. Now we have one chlorine atom as well. So chlorine is having a atomic number 17, so its valency will be 2, 8 and 7. So it is having 7 numbers of electron in its outermost orbit. So it needs one more electron, and this one more electron it gets from the sharing with the carbon atom. So this kind of sharing, to complete the octets or to get the nearest noble gas configuration or to stabilize the atom, here sharing of electrons is done. And what is sharing of electrons? This is the covalent bonding. So a covalent bond, which is representing here, which I am representing here by the dash line, this is a covalent bond which is made by the sharing of two electrons, each from the two different atoms. Here one is carbon, at one bond we have chlorine, and other three places we have hydrogen. So covalent bonding is done in CH3Cl. CH3Cl, Cl is chloro, one carbon is methane, so this is chloromethane by name. Question number 5 is, draw the electron dot structure for ethanoic acid, H2S, propane and F2. So for ethanoic acid we have already done, so we will not do it again. Let us start with H2S, propanone and F2. So first let us start with H2S. So as we know that hydrogen is having a valency of 1, it can share only one electron, where sulfur is having a valency of 6. And it needs two more electrons to complete its octet. So it can share two electrons with hydrogen. But as hydrogen can only donate once, two hydrogen atoms are used in this way, that we have sulfur which is having 6 electrons like this. And we have hydrogen atoms beside the sulfur, which are sharing their one electron with the sulfur. This way hydrogen atom is forming one bond with the sulfur. This way H single bond, S single bond, H. So this way H2S is formed. Then we have propanone. So let us do propanone here. So two things you can understand from the name, that non ketone group is there, propane, that means three carbon atoms are there. So first we will draw the three carbon atoms. So ketone group cannot be on the terminal, so it will be on the middle carbon only, and rest of the valencies we have to fulfill using the hydrogen. So we will be having CH3COCH3. Then we have F2, that is fluorine. So we have two atoms of fluorine, or you can say a molecule of fluorine we have, and we know that fluorine is having atomic number 9, so its electronic configuration becomes 2 and 7. So it needs one more electron to complete its octet. So it can share one electron of its outermost orbit with another fluorine. This way, that it is having another fluorine is also having the same number of valence electrons, and these two electrons of from each fluorine are getting shared in the covalent bonding. Hence one single bond is formed between the fluorine atoms. Question number 6 is, what is an homologous series? Explain with the examples. So we have already discussed it, that homologous series is a group of organic compounds which are having similar structures and similar chemical properties, and each successive compound differs by a group CH2 and a mass 14 units. Or you can say that homologous series is having carbon compounds of different numbers succeeding by CH2 group, and the same functional group is attached to the all the compounds of same series. So let us have an example. So So for alkanes, we have the general formula CnH2n+2. So if C is 1, then it will be 4, CH4. Then we will have C2H6, C3H8, C4H10. This is an alkane homologous series, but it is not having any functional group. So let us see one example for functional groups. Let us have example of alcohol group. So alcohol group can be CH3OH, then we can have C2H5OH, C3H7OH. So you can see the same functional group is there, only the difference in each successive member is CH2, that is a difference of mass unit 14. Question number 7 is, how can ethanol and ethanoic acid be differentiated on the basis of their physical and chemical properties? So in this solution, if we differentiate between ethanol and ethanoic acid on the basis of their physical properties, so the first property can be smell. As we know that ethanols are alcohol functional group, so it will be having an alcoholic smell, or which is pleasant. And ethanoic acid is having a strong smell like vinegar. The second point can be their boiling point. So the boiling point for ethanol is 351 Kelvin and ethanoic acid 391 Kelvin. So this can be the difference, or melting point can be the difference. That for ethanol we have the melting points at 156 Kelvin, whereas for ethanoic acid we have this value as 210 Kelvin. So these can be the physical basis on which we can differentiate between the ethanols and ethanoic acid. Then let us see the chemical properties. So if we talk about the chemical properties, the first nature we can talk is their nature or effect on the litmus paper. So ethanol will not change the color of the litmus paper, either it is red or blue, because it is neutral in nature. But ethanoic acid is acidic in nature, so it will turn the blue litmus to red. If we talk about the reaction of ethanol and ethanoic acid, then we have studied then reactions with the metal carbonate or metal hydrogen carbonate. Ethanol is not giving any reaction with the metal carbonates or metal hydrogen carbonates, but ethanoic acid is reacting with the metal hydrogen carbonates, and production of carbon dioxide is there, which produces the effect called effervescence. One more differentiation can be done on the basis of using alkaline potassium permanganate, that is KMnO4. Alkaline KMnO4. If we use it with the ethanol, then in case of ethanol, if we are having ethanol in a test tube and we put alkaline KMnO4 to it, then the color of potassium permanganate will disappear. The color of KMnO4 is purple in color, so this will disappear in the case of ethanol, but there is no change, or the color will not disappear in case of ethanoic acid. So these can be the physical and chemical basis to distinguish between the ethanol and ethanoic acid. Question number 8 is, why does the micelle formation takes place when the soap is added to the water? Will a micelle be formed in the other solvents such as ethanol also? This you can understand with the help of this diagram, which we have seen earlier as well, that when we dissolve the soap in the solution, water, you can say, which is having a surface with some dirt or oil on it. Then first, as we add up the solution, as we add up the soap to the water solution, first the ions, the soap molecules, are distributed in the water. As they are having a non-polar tail and a polar head, so they will roam around the water molecules in this solution. But a certain limit comes, or you can say a critical micellar concentration. When the concentration of the soap molecules becomes so much that now they cannot remain in the water solution, so they form the micelles. That means they go to the dirt particles, align themselves in such a way that hydrophilic part is in the water and hydrophobic part is attached to the dirt, oil or grease. So this way micelle formation takes place. But no micelle formation will take place in ethanol because the alkyl chain of the soap becomes soluble in alcohol even before the forming micelles with dirt, and no hydrophobic is left to stick with the dirt. So micelle formation will not take place in the alcohols. Next question is, why are the carbon and its compounds used as fuels for most of the applications? Because the carbon compounds have covalent bonds which stores a large amount of energy, which is released when these molecules are burned or when they react with the oxygen to form carbon dioxide and water. So a large amount of energy is released which can be used as a fuel. That is why most of the carbon and its compounds are used as fuels. Question number 10 is, explain the formation of scum when hard water is reacting or treated with soap. So when soap molecule, which is a long chain of carboxylic acid and sodium salts. So sodium salts of long carboxylic acids are called soap. So when soap reacts with the hard water, what happens? Because hard water is containing calcium and magnesium ions present in it in large amount. So when soap reacts with the calcium or magnesium, then the salts of calcium and magnesium are produced and sodium ions are released. And these salts are soluble in, they are insoluble in water, so they will precipitate out. This arrow is showing the precipitation of the calcium salt of soap molecule. Then magnesium salt will also be insoluble, so they will precipitate down, and this precipitate will be grayish white in color, and this grayish white insoluble precipitate is known as scum. Question number 11 is, what change will you observe if you test the soap with the litmus paper, red or blue? So, as we know that soap is acidic in nature, question number 11 is, what change will you observe if you test soap with a litmus paper, red or blue? So, as we know that soap is basic in nature, so it will turn the red litmus into blue color. However, the color of blue litmus paper will remain the same. Next question is, what is hydrogenation and what is its industrial applications? So hydrogen, we know that hydrogenation is a chemical reaction between the molecular hydrogen and other compounds or elements, usually in the presence of catalysts like nickel, palladium or platinum. As we have done, the hydrogenation of vegetable oils to convert the vegetable oils into vegetable ghee, that is to the conversion of unsaturated oil into saturated fat, is done with the help of hydrogenation in the presence of some catalysts like nickel, palladium or platinum. So one industrial application we have seen that these are used to prepare the vegetable ghee from the vegetable oil. So we can say that in food industry hydrogenation is used, and it is also used in petrochemical industries where the hydrogenation is used in the manufacturing of gasoline and petrochemical products, and in the production of liquid fuels also it is used. In the medicines, we use selective hydrogenation of alkynes to produce vitamins. The next question is, which of the following hydrocarbon undergo the addition reaction? And the examples given to us are C2H6, C3H8, C3H6, C2H2, CH4. So CH4, we know that it is a methane alkane. So one more important thing about the addition is that only unsaturated hydrocarbons can undergo addition reactions. So we have to find out only the unsaturated hydrocarbons from it. C2H6 is not the unsaturated hydrocarbon. C3H8 is also saturated hydrocarbon. C3H6 and C2H6 both are unsaturated hydrocarbons, so they will only undergo the addition reaction. Now next question is that give a test that can be used to differentiate between the unsaturated and saturated hydrocarbons. So we can take the example of but unsaturated compound. We know the saturated hydrocarbons, they do not interact with any other compound or they are less reactive, whereas the unsaturated hydrocarbons are more reactive. So we will do the bromine water test with both the compounds. Bromine water is brown in color. So when we add up the bromine water to butter and oil contained in the test tubes, then after a while the disappearance of the deep brown color of the bromine will take place in one of the test tubes, and that will be the unsaturated hydrocarbon. So that will be the oil, and the rest which is not reacting with the bromine water to disappear its color will be the butter. So this way we can differentiate between the unsaturated and saturated hydrocarbon. Question number 15 is, explain the mechanism of cleansing action of soaps. And the solution is that when the soap is applied, the non-polar hydrocarbon part of soap molecule dissolves in the oil droplets, while the polar, that is COO negative and Na plus group, remains attached to the water molecule because it is hydrophilic in nature. In this way, each oil droplet gets surrounded by the non-polar chains of hydrocarbons, and the heads of each of the soap molecule will remain on the surface. This way a spherical aggregate is formed around the oil or dust, and this is called a micelle formation. And because of this micelle formation, this dirt or oil is entrapped in the micelle, and with the force of water or by agitating the liquid, we can throw away, or this dirt particle will be removed from the container or from the water. This way the cleansing action of soap takes place. So this is it for today's lecture. In next lecture, we will be discussing the assignment that I'll be providing to you today itself, and I'll be giving you one day time to solve the assignment. So you have to solve the assignment by tomorrow, and next day we will be discussing the answers. So probably on Monday you will be having the assignment solutions. And you remember that you have to send the solutions to me on my email ID by 12 a.m. every day. So students, take care and goodbye.